Hello, welcome to the Department of Italian Studies, NYU, and the Casa Italiana Derrili Marimont. My name is David Forgach. I'm currently acting chair of the Department of Italian Studies. I work right at the other end of the historical spectrum from the Middle Ages, so I'm here to learn rather than to educate anybody. But it's my pleasure to introduce the three speakers tonight. I think first I want to introduce Maria Luisa Ardizzone because she's the star of the show. She's professor of Italian literature here at NYU. Her main research areas are, let me get this right, medieval poetry, philosophy, politics and science, rhetoric, and intellectual history. But she also works on 20th century poetry. And her main publications include Reading as the Angels Read, Speculation and Politics in Dante's Banquet, the Convivio, University of Toronto Press 2016, Dante, il Paradigma Intellettuale, Un Invenzio degli Anni Fiorentini, published by Olschke in 2011, Guido Cavalcanti, The Other Middle Ages, University of Toronto Press 2002, Italian edition 2006. And then Ezra Pound, Machine Art and Other Writings, The Lost Thought of the Italian Years, published by Duke University Press, 1996. And Ezra Pound e la Scienza, Scritti Inediti Orari, published by Shai Villa in 87. And her latest book, and the one that is being presented today, is The Young Dante, Archetypes of His Early Intellectual Biography, published by Cambridge Scholars Publishing this year. And we have as the... I'm not sure if it's respondent, moderator, or discussant, but anyway, the other distinguished person here, Jane Tylus, who is professor, in fact, I think, let me just get your title right, she is Andrew Downey Orrick, Professor of Italian and Professor of Comparative Literature at Yale University. But she was, until 4 years ago, is that right, 2018, was here with us. She was our colleague, very much missed in this department, and also played a major role in NYU as Vice Provost for Academic Affairs, founder of the Humanities Initiative, it was then called, now Humanities Center of the Humanities. And Jane's primary research area is in late medieval and early modern European literature, religion and culture. But she has secondary interests like Maria Luisa, works on contemporary poetry and 20th century poetry. Jane also works on 19th and 20th century narrative fiction. I won't go through all her many publications, but I would like to mention the wonderful monograph Reclaiming Caterina di Siena, or Reclaiming Catherine of Siena, which won in 2010 the MLA's prize, Muraro Prize for Outstanding Book in Italian Studies. And I'd also mention that her work as a whole has focused on this recovery of lost or marginalized voices, dialects, minor genres like pastoral, secondary characters in plays and poems, and so on. And she's also been active in the practice and theory of translation. And she's currently working on a project called Saying Goodbye in the Renaissance, not saying goodbye to the Renaissance, saying goodbye in the Renaissance, part of which is coming out on the Cambridge Elements series next year. And also coming out is her translation of Dacia Marini's Chiara di Assisi, which she and Marini presented here in NYU in 2014. And that's coming out, I think, in December with Rutgers University Press. And finally, the other guest and respondent tonight is Leonardo Chiarantini here, who's a PhD candidate in the Department of Romance Languages and Literatures at the University of Michigan. He worked as teaching assistant at Middlebury College. He was research affiliate and adjunct instructor here in our department. And he works primarily on Dante's dialogue with his lyric forerunners, particularly in the central cantos of the Divine Comedy, and on Dante's use of Boethius's Consolation of Philosophy to refashion the lyric tradition that he inherited. He collaborated with the Società Dantesca Italiana, with the Dante Society of America, for which he was one of the curators of the project conceived by Alison Cornish, our chair who's on leave at the moment, Canto per Canto, Conversations with Dante in Our Time, co-produced here by the Casa Italiana. So enough of me. Please join me in welcoming our guests and for what should be an extremely stimulating discussion.
Take the floor.
Scusa. Gene, cosa faccio? Comincio io, allora leggo? Sì. Va bene.
I want to express my gratitude to Professor David Forgax, Professor Gentilus, and Leonardo Chiarantini, dottorando PhD, for being here and participating in this event. I have just a few pages to read, but are just two and a half. The book deals with Dante's Florentine years and traces a kind of intellectual biography of the young poet. These are the years in which he lives in Florence, participates in small social events, and searches for his own voice as a poet and intellectual. They are also the years in which the crucial event in his life is represented by his meeting and love for Beatrice. The young Dante is in part a rewriting of my previous book, Dante, il paradigma intellettuale, un invenzio degli anni fiorentini, 2011, and partially a new book, a full new book. While the focus of Il Paradigma was at that time my work in progress book on Dante's Il Convivio, which I published in 2016 with the title Reading as the Angels Read, Speculation and Politics in Dante's Convivio, the focus of the young Dante is the Commedia, in particular Dante's Paradiso, and the late Dante of the Questio, De Aqua et Terra. The pathway that Dante starts to trace is in fact foundational of his poetic and intellectual universe. The young Dante assumes the 80s and the first part of the 90s, 13 years, as a crucible of great importance and takes into consideration Dante's first book, De Vita Nuova, and two canzoni written a little later after the death of Beatrice, probably written in 1294, voi che intendendo il terzo ciel movete e amor che nella mente mi ragiona. The volume for the first time in Dante's criticism identifies what I term archetypes or primary forms for narrative and philosophical, forms both narrative and philosophical that the young poet takes from the ancient medieval culture and reshapes to build his own creative universe. The volume is organized in four chapters. In them I introduce and discuss first what Dante indicates as materia nuova and lode, new matter and praise, Vita Nuova 1718. From this archetype derive more archetypes, all foundational for Dante's future work. They are primary forms of Dante's attempt to explore the true essence of human beings, their power and weakness. Praise, defined by Thomas Aquinas as the language of angels, influences Dante's persistent inquiry into the essence of human beings, their partial similitude to the angel intelligences and what human beings can know. The book is based on a concentrated philological attention to the texts that I read. This includes attention to Dante's language, widely contextualized in the culture of Dante's time, in which philology encompasses the definition that Angelo Poliziano wrote centuries later, when in 1492 he was called to teach Aristotelian philosophy at the Studium Florentinum. In his orazione inaugurale, while declaring that he was not a philosopher, but a grammaticus, i.e. a philologist, he defined philology as an art of reading through the past that explores different kinds of writing or text to which history, philosophy, and linguistics are ancillary. In my introduction, while tracing Dante's early sentimental intellectual journey, I ask a crucial preliminary question. In these journeys, does Dante have a master? Do we recognize an intellectual guide? To approach and answer to these questions, I recall Raphael's famous Scuola di Atene, School of Athens, in the Apostolic Palace of Vatican Museums. At the center of his fresco, Raphael portrays the young Aristotle with his master Plato, walking and talking. They are both philosophers and both Greeks. Each holds a book in his hands, Plato the Timaeus, and Aristotle the Nicomachean Ethics. The two famous texts are eloquent signs of Raphael's intention to show the two different paths that their philosophical thoughts trace and that he suggests can be seen in their continuity and difference. Plato, as the champion of the world of ideas, is portrayed with a finger pointing up toward the heavens, whereas Aristotle, as heralding an earthly inquiry and perspective, is portrayed as a hand gesturing down toward the earth, in which ethics, of course, is central. Raphael's fresco was the result of an attempt to represent the idea that Plato and this school, the ideas that Plato and this school introduced and that were debated for centuries. Indirectly, the fresco represents time in a figurative form and includes the portraits of philosophers that run through the centuries from Pythagoras, Socrates, Proclus, Averroes, Leonardo, etc. Who then could be a candidate for the young Dante's master? To choose someone close to Dante is not easy. Despite this difficulty, in light of my reading and exploration, I have found not one, but two candidates. The first is Augustine, who mediates for the young Dante Platonism in his Latin Christian rereading, of which he, Augustine, is a major representative. The Augustine on whom I focus is not the Augustine of the Confessions, largely widely discussed by Dante scholars, but the Augustine of the Trinitate, the Doctrina Christiana, Sermones, and the commentaries on St. John's the Gospel, the Psalms, and the letters of St. Paul. This is the Augustine who deals with the rhetoric, the theory of language, and the philosophy. The other candidate is the poet Guido Cavalcanti, Dante's contemporary and first friend, as he is called in the Vita Nuova, the libello that Dante dedicates to him. Cavalcanti, in contrast with Augustine, is the mediator of an Aristotelian tradition in its most radical version, as his famous and high difficult canzone Donna me prega testifies. Dante's relation with Guido Cavalcanti, as my book shows, is characterized by a conflict between admiration and rejection. I document the evolution of this complex relation and the reasons, both intellectual and ethical political, that put an end to that friendship. The first primary form or archetype I consider is the introduction in the Vita Nuova of what we may call the interior world, as it is announced at the very beginning of the Vita Nuova. This interior dimension must be seen in relation to an event that is central to the Vita Nuova, the Incarnation. To understand this interior dimension, we must evaluate Dante's enigmatic claim that Incarnation, while announcing a new idea of a human being, postulates a new way of writing, to which the Vita Nuova testifies in a suggestive, hidden way, mostly constructed and pronounced through the complex figure of transumptio, which includes metaphor, nominatio, pronominatio, personificatio or prosopopia, Dante's libello imports into the vernacular of lingua del sì, a binary dimension, in which the human being is both one and other, the human and divine essence live together in him, and Beatrice functions as Christ's figure in this dimension. Dante's canzone, Donne che avete intelletto d'amore in De Vita Nuova, announces that this binary essence demands a new language, and thus a new way of writing in which this new dimension may enter and be pronounced. Dante is a great reader of John's Gospel, mostly in the Augustinian mediation. The identity of the Son and of the Word, as my study shows, is an object of sustained reflection for the young Dante. Dante brings in this idea in a dialogue with women whom he indicates as having intelligence of love. It is in this context that introduces praise at first, praise dedicated to Beatrice and defined infinite in the very first lines of the canzone Don che avete intelletto d'amore, is in the Neoplatonic tradition the language of return to God. This, according to a tradition testified by authors such as the Pseudo-Dionysius, Proclus, Alain de Lille, who are all Dante's authors. But in the Augustinian tradition, as testified by Gregory the Great in that seminal book, Morale and Job, preserved in the library of Santa Croce at Dante's time, we have a passage important in relation to the Vita Nuova. Gregory uses Augustine's theory of language and declares that praise is an interior language shared by intellectual beings. Leta Aquina, in his Summa Theologia, will write that praise is the language of angels because the angels, in their admiration for God, can only praise him. In Donne che avete, Dante, using Gregory the Great as a source, represents the human being expressing himself through praise. Love represented too as a character who speaks the language of praise, declares the intellectual essence of human beings of love itself. Interior language is an archetype of a future growth and development, but here another question arises. How it is possible to bring this interior language of praise to the page if we are obliged to use an alphabetic language? In chapters 24 and 25 of the Vita Nuova, Dante establishes what the interior language is. He does so in a part that is complex, full of references to authors, a text from an ancient and medieval tradition. My book reconstructs this path by which Dante comes to shape his idea. Dante's invention in the classical rhetorical meaning of inventio, as the thing discovered in venire, is foundational for his future work. He starts to forge a link that connects the tropos of rhetoric, poetics, poetrie, and interior language, according to Augustine, who in the Trinitate identifies this language with thought. Interior language is formed by images. Thoughts are images. According to Hans Arendt, a German scholar of linguistics, Augustine identifies an itinerary in which thinking is initially presented as a cloud or foggy event in the mind. Then it is something indefinite. Then it takes one more definite form as an image. These images will be later expressed vocally. Chapter 25 of Vita Nuova shapes a kind of poetic theory. Poets of antiquity used tropes. Tropes are images, and the interior world is a vision or image. The language of poetry, openly constructed on images, identifies the new author, and Dante is recognized as being the bearer of the new world. The great invention here is that the language of poetry, because constructed on tropos or images, is identified as the natural language of the human mind. This is the initial intuition invention that is foundational for Dante's future theory of language, as will be discussed in his De Vulgari Eloquentia, later in Conde Convivio, then in Purgatorio 24, much later in the Paradiso. We can follow a further development of this theory, which the theory of interior world changes. Interior language is the first archetype I discuss in the volume, and from this many more derive. I think I can stop here, Jane, and we postpone the other things to our conversation. Okay, thank you.
Do you want me to lower the lights?
I don't know. Yes, probably this light is terrible. There is something che nel pass. Siamo abbagliati.
Okay. Well, Maria Luisa, thank you. That was a wonderful introduction to a wonderful book, and I can hardly recommend it to our audience. I think that, you know, what has especially struck me about it is that whereas most people...
Sorry.
That's okay, I can still see you. do you want to just stay up here, or...
I want to just to collect everything. So.
No, I think whereas when we think of the phrase Dante's journey, right, most of us think of the journey through Inferno, Purgatorio, Paradiso, and what you've done, and I would say not only in this book, but throughout much of your work over the last two decades, is to chart a very different kind of journey for Dante. You know, the journey of the Anni Fiorentini, as you say, in Il Paradigma Intellettuale, the journey of the Vita Nuova, the journey that leads from the Vita Nuova to the first two canzoni that will be eventually included in the Convivio, and a journey that is very much, not so much a journey about love for Beatrice, but a journey that is about love for the intellect. And the intellectual, and the philosophical, and the theological. And I think that in charting for us the journey of the young Dante in particular, I mean, you've made us all very eager to read what we hope will be a forthcoming book soon on Paradiso, as you were saying a few times just now, that this really leads toward the construction of narrative and language as we see it fully developed in Paradiso. But for now, you've really focused on these early years before the exile, obviously before the Commedia, and before the Convivio was actually written as a prose treatise as opposed to a selection of canzoni. So I think that this has been just an extraordinarily, for me, very refreshing and really original way of coming to Dante, thinking about these early years as formative in ways, not only for the Commedia, but for a whole new way of thinking and a whole new way of writing. And I think what I particularly appreciated, and this is where I can see your skill as a pedagogue. Maria Luisa was teaching until about 10 minutes before we started here at 6:30. And I can say, as having been her colleague here at Casa Italiana for 16 years, she is someone who devotes a great deal of her time to thinking about how to teach, not just what to teach and who to teach. And I think that what really emerges from the young Dante, as well as from some of Maria Luisa's other works, is a real interest in the process of thinking about one's readers and thinking about one's students. And so maybe my first question, which I hope emerges from this, has to do with what you would think of as Dante's process. Maria Luisa, you use words in your narrative such as Dante is constantly revisiting his earlier work. He's returning, he's reshaping. This is a conversation that for Dante, you know, whether it's about love, whether it's about the intellect, whether it's about praise, whether it's about the true donna, whoever she may be, there are a set of concepts and a set of questions that guide much of his intellectual life. And so I'm curious, in terms of charting out for us this process of the young Dante, the Anni Fiorentini, such as they were, what is continuous in that process as we look toward the Commedia, and what gets left behind?
Okay, thank you, Jane, for what you said, also this question. I have to use this, yes? I have to say that this book precisely wants to create a path toward the commedia. I am writing on the commedia. There is another book I am working on before the commedia, always Dante and we can say the poets who were around Dante, but also Dante dealing with the politics. But the book on the commedia, if you want to say something new on the commedia, is very, very difficult. And it's useless to write another book in which I discuss things already discussed, rediscussed. That is really something that we have to escape from. The scholarship needs new approaches. So, what is in this book that guides me toward the commedia? The first I have indicated in what I have read is precisely this idea that Dante wants to change, or we should say to enter into the relationship between what the human being is and which kind of writing could express the essence of this being. Is incarnation is not an event that belongs to theology. It's in everyday life for Dante, in every page of what he writes in the Vita Nuova. It is the invention of this interior language, which is as an history, which derives from Plato and arrives to modernity with great texts written by people like William Ockham, Dan Scotto, but all follow Augustine. Augustine has been a maestro in such theory. So I did have the chance to enter into this note and what derives from that. Not just in the book. In the book I trace the path. And the path that Vita Nuova, read in this perspective, allows is that Dante did not start to discuss, as everybody knows in this room, mostly scholars of Dante, he does not discuss at first this issue in the Vulgari Eloquentia. He starts precisely in the Vita Nuova. In quella parte del libro della memoria, eccetera, how it starts, what we know, we learn, is that he's copying from something which is written in his mind. And so to write is to rewrite. This is strongly linked to the idea that we have an interior world inside which is not organized in alphabetical forms. And Augustine creates this enormous text. He confronts this issue. Essentially, I have taken into consideration Sermo 288 and also a part of his On Trinity, which is a book of great, great importance. And on the wake of Augustine, Gregory the Great, and other people. So this dimension shapes the discourse in the Vulgari Eloquentia. I have to say that I have written an essay in which I have explained precisely, this I have written just 2 months ago, in which I explain that since he did not start with the Vita Nuova, with the Vulgari Eloquentia on the theme of language, but it starts before in the Vita Nuova, and we have to take into account this interior language, the theory of language that usually scholars think is Dante's theory is totally wrong. And I have explained why. Now it's too long to explain, but it is this theory. And there is something so important, which is what Dante means with interior world. It's a plexus. is something we have inside, which guarantees the beginning of language. Also in Dante's the Vulgari Eloquentia, in Dante's Paradiso, Canto 24 of Purgatory, etc., deals with that. But going beyond this interior world, which however is so complex that opens this inquiry, I wanted to focus on another aspect. Dante invents something important when in the canzone he will later comment in the convivio, voi che intendendo il terzo ciel movete, he speaks about the angels, he proposes something that remains open, that is that speculation is not just speculation. To speculation has to follow action. So what he does, he explains this both later, but much later. Here is the paradigm or the moment of importance. Why? Because he is inventing a relationship between the angels who move the heavens in virtue of their contemplation to God. He does not say everything. He is implicit for everybody who knows these theories. Why? Dante tells us that he was frequenting the convents of Florence, he was following the disputazione dei filosofanti. Who were these filosofanti? There are scholars who have worked on that. Filosofanti is not a generic word. For this we know other scholars have discussed this issue. Filosofanti implies precisely the people like Dominicans and others who were asserting that the angels' intelligences of the pseudo-Dionysius taken from the Bible, etc., were the same people who were moving the heavens. That is, the link was made between the biblical Neoplatonic tradition and Aristotle of Book 12 of Metaphysics. Now, for Dante, this is extremely important. And the canzone shows Dante's attempt to see at first what speculation is. There is the story of the woman, the new woman, the betrayal of Beatrice. This is the soap story. Everybody discusses this issue. It's nothing. The point is that all this is speculation. Speculation implies in Dante, in this canzone, the entrance of Aias, the entrance of a new woman who brings inside the great topic, if the human being is able to speculate. Here, the likeness to the angels who speculate and move the heavens means they give life to the world, and the fact that this human being probably is able to speculate, but what he can do. So this is a tormented point for Dante, and the canzone stops when Dante gives this answer, yes, we are able to speculate. And then, this is my idea also, that the other canzone is written in continuity with this, the other says, yes, we speculate, and what we do with this speculation? This is an open issue. Dante will give answer in years. And at the same point here in the book, I have quoted, I don't need to read the text, as an epigraph, I have put that speculation is not something that is important in itself. It is important, of course, but is important in gratia actionis, pragma, so that Dante wants to find the possibility to think that the human being speculation is something which creates the ground for a better way of life, for something he will call at the end of Monarchia, earthly paradise, possible in the history, not before the history. So, in my opinion, now it's difficult to give all the passages which would be important, but I say just this. What, in my opinion, is Dante's attempt in relation to such thinking, which is a tormented thinking, is what can be the sense of writing, for instance, the paradise, paradiso, the third canticle, can be that the human being knows that after life he will be happy if he is blessed? I don't think so. It is not enough. I think that the idea is that there are two. There is a double register. One is what we read. This is something I said, something like that today in class. And the other is a white page in which there is what the reader can get from that. So that the point is the formation of the reader. This creates a parallel match. In the century which invented, they used the double match. Dante has a double register, I think. This is extremely important. So the notion of speculation that has to become action is formative for what he writes. I have mentioned it in the Paradiso, but probably there is much more to be said.
Well, that was a very complete and systematic response to my question. Thank you. And you know, and I'd like to follow up with a couple of things, Maria Luisa. One is, one of my favorite phrases in your book is you say something to the effect that, you say toward the very end, that Dante's poetry is full of suggestions and few certainties. Many suggestions and few certainties. That is to say, you've just used words like opening and speculation and the fact that he's interested in the reader's own blank page and what the reader will go on and continue to write and what the reader will go on and continue to do. So I think your emphasis just now on pragma, right, on the pragmatic outcome, the ethical outcome, the civic outcome, as you allude to continually in your book, is what's really important. That said, you know, a kind of a curiosity I had as I was reading, given that these are years somewhat prior to Dante's own civic engagement in Florence, but certainly looking toward that engagement in Florence, that is not something that you take up. Obviously, you're dealing with him strictly as a writer. But I'm just curious again, you know, given that so much of your emphasis in the book is on the rhetorical and ethical shaping of the individual through writing, and in a second I will ask you why the Vulgate is the language in which to pursue that, not Latin. But leaving that aside for a second, given that so much of your emphasis is on this rhetorical fashioning, as it were, of Dante as a writer and of the reader with his own or her own blank page, what would have been for Dante the ideal civic outcome or the ideal ethical outcome for himself? That is to say, yeah, in during the anni fiorentini, so before the exile, right?
This is interesting as a question. I did not write about
No, I know
that.
You didn't.
But I would say... And I would say that Dante's ethical choices at that point, no doubt in the Florentine years, are what can be taught and accepted about the powers and limits of the human being. So his relationship with Guido Cavalcanti implies at first a refusal of rejection of Cavalcanti's solipsism, because Cavalcanti practiced the solipsism instead of Dante believes in a community. I recall just something I say in the book about the fact that when Beatrice dies, Dante writes to the principi della terra. And in my opinion, according to what are also the sources Dante uses derived from the Bible, la città desolata, widow, città vedova, of course is the world, but Dante assumes that the lost of Beatrice is the lost for the city, implying that Beatrice, of course, means the word and the logos, what creates a community of speech and thinking, logos, rationality and speech. And in this is involved, because what is lost is something which belongs to him, but belongs to all the human beings. So every event, this is extremely important, has not just a personal meaning. This is a part of what I'm trying to say in the book, not the story of the donna gentile, a betrayal. Of course, he tells that, but also he writes, I have written this canzone not for love. The theme is not love, is virtue. Now, virtue, virtus, in the Latin Dante is using for this word, implies or moral virtues or intellectual virtues. I suggest, in the book I have suggested that both the two belong to Dante. So Dante looks for finding a life of harmony with the people around him, a kind of sympathos, we can say, and also to discover the true sense of the life of human beings. And when he looks for understanding what is really speculation, of course he is looking for that. I recall just that Dante is a great reader of the Gospel of St. John. I said that, and he uses this famous, I translate in English, now we cannot know God during the life, but we can in per speculum and in enigmate. Now, this is an issue of great importance. In everyday life we can find God, because things created by God, this is the meaning as been explained by many people, among them the great exegesis on that of Augustine and the Trinitate, and things have the image of God imprinted in them. So through specula we can reach God. But the word in enigmate, this is difficult. I did have the fortune to enter in touch with a scholar, Eleanor Cook. She has written a crucial essay on that, because she is a scholar of rhetoric, that Tarsus, at the time of St. Paul, was a center of the studies of rhetoric. And St. Paul was a great scholar of rhetoric. And when he said enigmata, he said tropos, difficult to be understood, is a kind of rompicapo, impossible to understand. But why? Augustine explains, also in the Dottrina Christiana. What is difficult is sweet. Is sweet because it brings us close to God, who is the absolute intellectualitas.
No, that's a wonderful way of responding. I love your point about Cavalcanti's solipsism versus Dante's spirit of, you know, a community ethos, which I think certainly comes out in the writing as well as in the life. And, you know, it does lead me to my next question on why the Vulgate, you know, why the Vulgate is the language of choice. And I want to just come off your comment right now on the difficult. You have some wonderful pages talking about how difficulty is a quality that Dante believes in. It's the path to get to God. It's the path to get to divinity. It's a path to get to the beautiful. And it just reminds me of two quotes. I'm just going to run through them quite quickly, because I think that perhaps to a certain extent they might illuminate what you are doing here with a sense of difficulty. And then I want to get back to ask you why the Vulgate as a mode of being able to depict the difficult. So one moment is Lorenzo de' Medici, who's writing in the late Quattrocento, so century and a half after Dante, two centuries after the Anni Fiorentini. And in his commento, Lorenzo de' Medici, who is defending the vernacular, defending the Tuscan vernacular, defending his own sonnets, talks about one of the great qualities of great art is precisely its difficoltà. And he goes back to a quote in Plato, where Plato talks about, you know, the difficult is what we all should be trying for and striving for. And for Lorenzo, the most difficult kind of poetry to write for him is reflected not in the canzoni, but the sonnet. Because the sonnet is such a metrically precise and very contained. You have to say a lot in a little space in the stanza that he talks about. So there's this one moment in Lorenzo de' Medici where he almost is returning to this theory of the difficult as something which the Vulgate is precisely capable of handling, and the sonnet
capable
is the
of
handling, and the sonnet itself is the vehicle through which the difficult is kind of expressed and attained. The second moment is a much more recent moment, and this is a quote that's always struck me. It's a quote by a recent commentator on Rilke, Rainer-Maria Rilke, the German poet of the early 20th century, in writing of the Duino elegies, and this scholar mentions, as he's going through the difficulties that Rilke sets us out that are interpretive difficulties in the elegies, he writes, "Ultimately, difficulty, not ease, is the way to a life of intense satisfaction." Rilke is telling us not to waste the difficulties and griefs of life and the harshness of our history, for they are the foundation of joy. And I've always found this quotation, again, kind of comforting in the midst of difficult times, as it were. But I think it also expresses something that's quite germane to your work and to the work that you're doing on Dante, is this sense that the more we engage in what is difficult, as it were, you know, ironically, perhaps the more pleasure that we get from that kind of work. So I want to just go back to the Vulgate as the appropriate medium for transmitting the difficult and for attaining what is difficult. Why the vernacular for this? Why not Latin?
Okay, listen. I have shaped this in my mind, just giving a few, I did touch this in my book on Convivio, but I did not say. My idea also because the reading of Anselm of Canterbury, who is a great reader of the tradition which establishes what is the interior world. And reading with attention the first book of Dante's Convivio, in which he discusses the issue of vernacular and Latin, you remember? And I think that Dante thinks this is a chapter of my new work. Dante thinks that actually the vernacular is the closest form of language close to the inner world. Mm-hmm. And I have written an essay on the importance of what is natural for Dante. Natural means that human beings express themselves naturally. And Anselm of Canterbury glosses in some ways Augustine without recalling him. He says, this interior world has no nationality, has no patria, is not Greek, Latin, or whatever it is, belongs to all languages. So I think, also reading the Vulgari, Dante thinks that the true language is the interior, and the others are idioms. And idioms implies to be close to the natural, but reformulating into an oral and written language, alphabetical, of course. This is, in my opinion. So, of course, he was using this. Of course, beyond that, He understood that if he wants to be read, he needs to have, this is also written in the Convivio, non ha conversazione in latino. And here we have Professor Lansing, a great translator of Dante's Convivio. You will remember this phrase. He has made the translation which has been, I fall in love with this translation many years ago. However, now the point is, if he's so close, is natural, is important. But if it has a conversation, is much more important.
Mm-hmm. No, that's...
So this is part of the politics.
Yes, no, and I like the fact that you're going back to precisely that issue of the ethics and the rhetoric and the civil conversation.
I didn't want to speak about the rhetoric, probably, but I didn't speak much in the book about it.
Well, you certainly bring out the importance of Dante's and Augustine's own consciousness of the rhetorical fashioning of language. And, you know, there are pages in which you also address the superiority of poetry to prose, right? That poetry
it's
has the ability.
Opinion.
Yes, exactly.
And has shaped the history of our culture, yeah, Italian culture.
Yeah. And so there's something that's also more rhetorical about poetry because it can indulge in more figures like similitudine, for example, than prose itself. So I do think that the rhetorical aspect of this is quite important, I guess, and I certainly want to leave Leonardo time for your commento. I just might have one. I have many more questions.
Beyond every border.
No, but I do have one more question, and it ties into the conversation we're having about Cavalcanti and perhaps rhetoric too. And your final chapter, where you turn to the second canzone in the Convivio, voi che intendendo il terzo ciel muovete. You suggest, oh, the first, of course, the second one. Amor che, appunto, sì, ragiona, exactly. But you also refer to the first one, but exactly, your fourth chapter is on the second canzone. And you suggest, toward the end of that chapter and then in your conclusion, that Dante feels at this stage he's taking, and I think I'm quoting you here, too many risks. He's taking too many risks in terms of a heterodox or a potentially heretical point of view regarding the separate substance and the intellect. And so I'd love for you to say a little bit more about this. I know that one of the figures that you cite extensively toward the end of your book is Siger of Brabant, and what obviously Thomas Aquinas resisted in Siger's own works, as did many other Dominicans. Of course, in Paradiso 10, we see all of these various aspects of the Dominicans, you know, living together in the heaven of the sole, the heaven of the sun. And so clearly 20 years out, Dante is going to be very inclusive in his sense of what heterodoxy might be. I guess I'm just curious, as you talk about his own exposure in these years in Florence to various theological ways of thinking and ways of writing, do you see him decisively turning his back on some of these issues when he goes to write the Convivio, when he goes to write perhaps even the third canzone, only then to make a move toward inclusiveness in Paradiso? Is this a back and forth to that extent, or is this a continuous movement of leaving some of these earlier heterodox attitudes and writings behind? So I'll make that my last question, and then I'm very happy to turn things over to Leonardo.
Sorry,
after you.
Sorry, I said give you just a short answer. This is a part of my work. I have also organized that Theo Barolini is here or not? Theo. Heterodoxy, Dante and Heterodoxy is a symposium to which Theo participated for the first time. After that, we started this Global Dante project of New York. Heterodoxy has been an issue that certainly I did not want to find in Dante's as a young.
One gets that impression that you didn't want to find it.
Really unaware that this is possible in those years. Instead of reading the second canzone, Amor che nella mente mi ragiona, while Dante is continuing with this issue on the interior world, he enters here something so new, so different, because he starts by at first showing them that the new lady he falls in love with there is just a divine idea, costei pensò che mosse l'universo. And then this is he falls in love with an idea. What's the meaning of that? It's evident that is all allegorical, and the point is that this idea is something, someone to whom angels' intelligences look to, and human beings. But these human beings are not one individual human being. Are the word he uses is gente, which is a collective name. So a plurality of human beings look at. Here enter all the topics of prohibitions of 1270, 1277 in Paris, and then enters also the idea that the human being is able to contemplate an idea in the mind of God during the life. This was an issue complex, and Dante gives his own answer, tormented. This is crucial, important, not just here, in the convivio until the monarchia, and in the Dante's Paradiso. Monarchia will invent through this idea that human beings think together, and better when they think together, as Nardi said, collective, quoting an Averroist, John of Jandun. What happens is that if a human being think together, Dante invents a new subject of history, and the name he gives to that is Humanitas. Universal Humanitas is at its highest peak when lives in the Universal Empire. So there is politics and speculation together. This is since the beginning of the Monarchia, but it will enter again in the Paradiso. And in my opinion also the Purgatorio, this idea of a community starts to take shape. But, I mean,
okay, I'll still want to hear more about heterodoxy, but I want to turn things over.
So I first want to say that what I particularly like about your volume is how you consider the development of Dante's conception from the introduction of the matter of praise to the conception of the new lady as in constant dialogue with the lyric tradition that Dante inherited. So first and foremost, his first friend, Guido Cavalcanti, but also the one that Dante indicates in Purgatorio 26 as his father and the father of those who ever used a sweet, graceful rhymes of love, Guido Guinizelli. And you point out that the new kind of inaugurated by Donna Cavete Intelletto d'Amore is aware of the new path delineated by Guinizelli, particularly in his doctrinal canzone Al cor gentile impara sempre amore, that there is a new kind of subtlety that is aware of Guinizelli's subtlety. But you go on to argue that when two cantos earlier in Purgatorio 24, the character of Bonaggiunto Orbiciani refers to Donne Cavete as indeed the canzone that inaugurates the Nove Rime, there seems to be the indication that Dante's novelty is intended to surpass that of Guinizelli. So I guess my question for you is, considered against the backdrop of Guinizelli's novelty, how is Dante newer than the new?
Okay, precisely from what I have said before, and that Dante there is the definition of Dolce's Nuovo, we know in this canto, is focusing on the fact that using also Bonaggiunta as an interlocutor to say what he wants to say, but he gives to Bonaggiunta, they allows him to speak about that, is precisely the invention of the interior world, of the invention of the interiority as able to reshape the language of the poetry. So what I did is, thank you for this question. Jen, thank you for the question you asked. But I mean, what I did, how we work, is like elaborate with scattered tools. The fact that the Doges in Moho is a come amor, and I don't want to destroy the text of Dante. The writing is something dictates by love, dictated by love, is something on which every scholar of Dante has to reflect. Means what? There are 100,000 explanations. But if we want to use a philology, we have to go back to the sources. And sources are precisely what I have indicated, reading, and now I have more or less repeated. And this is, so what we do? We are in Canto 24 of Purgatorio. We go back to see if there is a trace of that. And when things match, probably Eureka, I have found something. That's the path I follow. So, of course, he was beyond Guinizelli, he was beyond the notary, Giacomo D'Alentini. Why? Because they did not take into account what the human being really is. This human being is not just who lives love. Who is the subject who lives love? Is what? That's. This is the meaning of this question in Canto 24. Okay,
so my second question for you is about the first canzone that will be eventually commented on in the Convivio, Voi che intendendo il senso ciel
muovete. Before the Convivio, it was written, that's the point. The,
yeah.
The canzone through the Convivio.
They will be eventually commented on in the Convivio. But I'm also going to ask you about the recollection of the canzone in the third cantica of the poem in Paradiso 8, when Charles Martyr recalls the incipit of the canzone, and the concern of the canto is very much with free judgment, with free choice. Dante, as most of you know, asks a crucial question to the character of Charles Martyr, and the question is, how can a sweet seed descend from a bitter one? There is an evil offspring from good ancestors. And the answer is that we are nature provedute, meaning that we do have dispositions that are inclined to the good, but we have free judgment, and we can either act accordingly with this disposition or stray from them. Now, my question is, would you say that the discourse on celestial causality of the Paradiso canto is consistent with the canzone, or there is a reconsideration, a supersession, or at least an expansion upon the canzone?
Thank you for this question. I disagree at all with the fact that since the canto deals with what you have mentioned, the meaning is that the canzone has inside this meaning. No, it's another issue in my opinion. And I have to say that here, Petrocchi, Vita di Dante, has been crucially important in order to grasp this meaning, which is fitting with what I see in the canzone. I have mentioned the relationship between speculation and action. So when he meets Charles Martel, for him he's not in Florence, he has written this canzone, it seems, for him, or however, in occasion of his visit to Florence. What happens is that probably the angels' intelligences speculate and move the world, presides over the world, in the same way in which someone who has power in man, in the hands, to rule the world, should not that without speculation there is no action. That's the point, reversing the succession. This is my idea about that. We spoke about that.
Yeah. But I do agree with you, actually. But since you only briefly referred to Paradiso 8, I wanted to hear it from you, if you thought that there was a consistency or not. So you answered the question.
In my opinion, there is not, also because the major consistency in a canto in which love is treated as a friendship. There is no doubt that Aristotle in books 10 and 11 of Nicomachean Ethics speaks about friendship as a politic, the ideal link of the life of politics. Friendship is this. So this changes the point. I mean, that issue is important, but there are many directions. This is continuous in Dante, many directions that, as Jane has recalled, not always he concludes the path he opens. So it remains for us to be understood that this is part of what I think is the attempt of a formation of his reader, which is an issue not just intellectual, but also political. He wants to create a world of people different from what probably sometimes has seen.
All right. My last two questions are less specific. They're broader questions, and I just would like you to speak a bit more about what you call a discontinuous continuity between Donne Cavete and the two canzoni, Voi che intendendo in Amor che nella mente. We respect specifically about the role of the sensible. My impression, but it could be just my feeling, is that, so praise is the component that links the three canzoni, and praise entails, as you point out, an intellectual vision, the ability to see in the sensible what is intellectual. And my feeling is that later on, there is a greater emphasis on the limitations inherent in being tied to the sensible in the second canzone, In Amor che nella mente. It seems to me that the limitation of the sphere of the sensible is more underscored. So I was wondering if you could say more about this continuous continuity between the canzoni, but with respect particularly to the role of the sensible.
Okay, in the book I list not just Donne Cavete and the other two canzoni, but all the line Dante gives us of praise in the Vita Nuova. So I try to link such line with the two canzoni, but actually the canzone in which we find praise is the second one, not the first. But this vocative initial implies always something like a praise or a prayer. It was, they were both the two, linked in the Neoplatonic tradition of Boethius. He's a scholar of Boethius. And so, Severinus Boethius. And so I want to say this continuity, when I spoke about that, I did not speak about the sensible, etc. The idea is that while the praise in the Vita Nuova, so all these lines, starting with Donne che avete intelletto d'amore and the prose, which is related to such a canzone, is, I would say, theological oriented. In the two canzoni strays, and here starts what we call heterodoxy. So this is a continuity, but discontinuous. Now the praise is for an idea, but how the human being can praise the idea? This is also in Grinzeri, but what a human being during the life would know of this, how he can contemplate. For instance, Albert the Great assumes that this is possible. Thomas Aquinas denies the condemnation of 1277, lists many errors derived from such idea. And of course, this is an idea that is cultivated by Cicero de Brabant. I quote him precisely because his line of heterodoxy is active there. Thank you, Leonardo, for that. Leonardo has been my student in a course I have given on three courses. And in one we were reading at one certain point, it was a course on Sublime, and we were reading Michelangelo, so difficult poetry, and suddenly I did have a great esteem for him, of course, but when he read Michelangelo, I was astonished, because he was so fast in understanding textos also that he did not know before, that I said he has to work on poetry. No, no doubt about that. So that's, thank you.
Do we want to open the conversation up to our audience?
Okay, thank you very much, Jane, for your questions, which were subtle, as you are usually, and and Leonardo for his questions, intelligent as usually you are. Subtle and intelligent, both the questions, okay.
Could you please respond with your microphone, please? So it's said that we're really good at seeing other people, but sometimes when they see us, we don't see ourselves. And my reference point is that Dante, I'm interested in Dante's sense of humor, his irony. And when it is said that when Dante had taken the manuscripts to be copied in the monastery, that the monks were laughing. And I wonder if Dante saw himself as a comedian, as a court jester, as irony. Did you sense his humor in his youth?
I don't like irony. So I study irony, I don't see irony. I can see senses like allegorical, etc. But irony, no, sorry. Irony, no, I did not deal with that. But it's a suggestion for the future, no doubt. But I did not deal with that.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Any other questions? Yes.
Grazie. Thank you so much for your presentation. It was really great. This word speculation, I really got stuck on it. And unfortunately, my Italian is not so good. So I'm wondering if you can say more about this word and if the English word speculation really captures what you're trying to say, or is there another word or an expansion of that word that helps to illuminate what this means, this idea of speculation? Like, is it developing a vision for life?
Continue.
No, because you said it, maybe I misunderstood, so I'm sorry, but this idea of speculation creating like an inner life that can then create some kind of earthly paradise or a better way of living, maybe? Like, what is this idea of speculation?
No, I did not think about that, but now I tell you what I know about that. So the word speculation, of course, derives from speculum, but we deal always with words which derive from Latin, but in the translation from Greek. So, for instance, in Aristotle, book 10 of Nicomachean Ethics, the highest virtue is contemplation or speculation. It implies theoretikon. So now theoretikon implies the word theos, that is God. So Thomas Aquinas, who does not know Greek but knows everything, more or less, he gives an explanation of speculation which is great, because he said implies always to reduce, to bring back all things to the Creator. Now, if we think in terms not theological, we can say speculation implies that we look at the things through reflection. All this vocabulary implies always something related to light. because God was represented as light in a great tradition of the Middle Ages. And so, if reflection implies also the ray that comes out from a source of light and goes back, you understand that?
Well,
reflection.
Right.
This is the incident ray, it goes back. So this implies to go back to the source.
Right, it reminds me of, I think, this quote of Augustine where he says, he has his back, he's facing what the light is shining on, but he has his back to the source of the light.
Yeah.
Whereas this is maybe really turning to the light itself.
When, however, St. Paul says, per speculum, what is, implies not light, but it does imply that all things are images of God, that is, all created things are images of God. So it's a complex issue. But when I use the word speculation, for the first canzone, I use mostly the idea that is Aristotelian. Of course, the angels speculate God. How they speculate God? Because they have inside a likeness to him. This is part of what I have written. And such likeness is because they have ideas in them. So they copy the ideas that are in the mind of God because they are able to look inside. And when they copy these images, they try these ideas, images, because they are thoughts. They are able, according to the medieval ideas, this is in Thomas Aquinas and other people, they are able to bring such ideas in the world of history, of time, of physics. This preserves the life in the cosmos. So this is a complex issue. Dante confronts this in the Convivium. And I have found traces of that also in his question, De Aqua et Terra. And without having this notion actually part of this question, which is the latest text Dante has written just a few months before he died, we don't have the perfect understanding of this question. So this is my work in progress now.
Thank you.
I can give you one more question, any final thoughts or curiosities? Well, let me just close by thanking Louisa for writing a book. If I had had time to ask one more question, and I'm not going to ask her to answer it now, it's just to comment on what I feel has been her own Dantesque-like mode in revisiting, reshaping, returning to, sometimes erasing earlier works and earlier meditations, from her book on Guido Cavalcanti to her work on the intellectual paradigm of the early Florentine years, and especially to her wonderful book in 2016, Reading Like the Angels, right? How do we think angelically? How do we think in metaphors of praise? So in the last, again, at least 20 years of her own incredible intellectual career, Maria Luisa has continued, like Dante, to go back to these
places, like Dante,
to revisit, to reshape, to rethink. And you really look forward to the next intellectual journey that you'll be going on as you move toward works like Paradiso. So, Maria Luisa, thank you so much.
Thank you, Jen, for such generous asking questions for establishing the main points of the book, and thanks Leonardo for that such interesting question too. Thank you everybody for being here.